showing emotion at a sports event is expected, right? Showing emotion at a wedding or even at a party is anticipated. Depending on what kind of Christian tribe you are familiar with, showing emotion within Christian circles, again, depending on what tribe, may be considered undignified, or in some cases people would say, oh, that's just contrived emotion. Certainly the world would consider expressing emotion over Jesus to be odd. Religion is intended to be kept in a box, the world would have us say. Now, if it helps you, that's fine. You just show it on Sunday mornings from 10:30 till noon, or if the preacher's long-winded, 12:15, right? But certainly keep it there. But don't talk about a relationship with Jesus. That's kind of creepy. In our text this morning, I feel like we're on holy ground. I feel like we're on holy ground, friends, for this reason, because we are getting a front row seat to a woman's life. And she kindly has allowed us to kind of peer into her life, and what we see is not the sin by which she was known. What we should be walking away with is the grace of God on display in this woman's life. But our text isn't just about this one woman. If you were listening to Trisha as she read, when we got into chapter 8, all of a sudden we were confronted with, I didn't know Jesus had an entourage, almost like an entourage of women who traveled with him, at least in chapter 8 he did. At a minimum three, but it looks like there's even more than that. So we're actually being exposed to not just how God changes one woman's life, but how he's changed multiple women's lives. And in the Old Testament, what made this so interesting was this, is that in the New Testament era, when Jesus is ministering and serving, is women were considered second-class citizens at best. Now, in the Old Testament, that was not true. In the Old Testament, women experienced much of community, as much community life as any man would. There was only one position that a woman did not occupy in the Old Testament, and that is the position of other than that, women interacted as far as owning businesses, selling property, Proverbs chapter 31. Now, women, when God gave his covenant to the nation of Israel at Mount Sinai, women were expected to be there. When scriptures were read publicly, women were expected and anticipated to be there. They were not excluded from worship in the temple, even though in the New Testament that would happen, because women were excluded. They were not excluded from the temple, whether it was worship or playing music. Psalm 68 teaches us this. They would pray publicly in the temple. 1 Samuel chapter 1 teaches us this. They would sing and dance with men in religious processions. So if you're uncomfortable singing out loud, I would be really uncomfortable if you see me dance in front of you all, right? But women and men were dancing in religious procession at 2 Samuel chapter 6. Miriam, who is Moses' sister, leads worship in Exodus chapter 15. And by the time the New Testament times roll around, though, the Jewish people began to reflect not Old Testament scripture, but they actually began to reflect the pagan cultures around them, thus putting women into a kind of a secondary or second-class role. For instance, the rabbis would not even teach Jewish women or Jewish girls. So Jesus is revolutionary in his ministry, not just to women, but he's revolutionary in this, that he's involving them in his ministry. So this morning our message is titled, Jesus and Women. I want to give us really just very simply three simple observations from Luke chapter 7. And here's the first one, is this, lavish worship. Look at verse 36 of Luke chapter 7. We read this. One of the Pharisees asked him, Jesus, to eat with him. And he went into the Pharisee's house and he took his place at the table. And behold, a woman of the city, who was a sinner, when she learned that Jesus was reclining at table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of ointment. And standing behind him as he weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head and kissed his feet and anointed them with the ointment. Let me ask you a question. Does this appear extreme to you? I want to begin with the cultural setting first and foremost. This meal is not a private affair. Whenever a Pharisee would invite a famous rabbi in, when a rabbi was kind of what they would call stringing pearls together, it was expected that people would be able to come in and observe this rabbi. So Jesus, the rabbi from Galilee, is taking the Jewish world by storm, and this Simon the Pharisee, this is 15 minutes of fame, so he's going to get his picture and put it up on Facebook so everybody can see that he too knows this famous rabbi from Nazareth. This meal is not a private affair, but because of the description of this woman, it was amazing that she actually would have kind of the courage to walk into this room, because she is described as a woman of the city. More about that later. Jesus had become famous for his teaching and his miracles. And no doubt word had gotten out that Jesus was eating with Simon the Pharisee. Middle East, you do not sit at a table like you and I would do, pull up a chair. No, you would recline, usually on your left arm, propped up with some pillows, on a low-lying table, and you would use your right hand to grab the food and eat, and you would kind of lie around in a circle around the table. It was intended for fellowship, camaraderie. So Jesus' feet are out behind him. This woman had heard this, and she comes to listen to his teaching. No doubt she had probably, in times gone by, she had been standing along the kind of the outskirts of the crowd as Jesus would be teaching. The Bible describes her as a woman of the city. Maybe an older generation, maybe my parents' generation, would describe her as a woman of the streets. She was a prostitute. She was an immoral woman. The church tradition, and again, it's just church tradition. We have nothing in the text that actually tells us this, but in church tradition, it says in Luke chapter 8, when we're introduced to Mary Magdalene, the woman with seven demonic spirits, that maybe this was the woman here in Luke chapter 7. We're unsure. And while much is unsaid, three different times in the text, the Bible clearly says she's a sinner. She's a sinner. And Jesus will say this: she has much sin. But apparently, she heard Jesus' teachings and accepted them for herself. And when she learns the location of Jesus, she has one goal in mind. She is going to do the one act of worship that she can do. And she brings an alabaster flask with her. It was fairly typical of Jewish women to keep a small alabaster flask. You can see the picture on the screen behind me. That's enlarged. That's actually from, prior to the time of Christ, that alabaster flask. They would keep a tie around their neck, and so maybe that she's taking that, but she's coming to anoint Jesus' feet. It was a long neck that they would do to release the oil as they would kind of break or snap the top of it, thus releasing the scented oil. Much like perfume, and again, commentators kind of argue back and forth on what the value of something like this would have been. Was it, $60,000? Was it $16,000 or $6,000? Regardless of what degree you come down on, this was a valuable flask of perfume with a great wealth. This was lavish worship. And if this extravagance isn't enough, though, when she enters the room, she notices Jesus' feet, because when you entered a home, specifically a Pharisee's home, and primarily if you were a person of notoriety, there were three things that would happen. First, you were greeted with a kiss. You were kind of held by the shoulders and ceremonially kissed. If you were, even if the second thing that happened is your feet would be washed. For shoes in that day were simply just a leather on the bottom with straps tied around. And so those shoes would be removed, and an appointed servant would wash the guest's feet. Again, this is reserved. These three items are reserved for special guests, but even sweet-smelling incense would be burned, or a portion of that incense would be kind of dropped on a person's head. So when this lady comes in, she notices immediately Jesus' feet lying out. They are unwashed. Whoever the appointed servant was did not take that basin of water and wash Jesus' feet. That was the basic, the most common of courtesy, like what you and I would do if someone comes to our house and say, you want a glass of water. That was the baseline of common courtesy in that day. This woman, whose life has been forever changed, is touched by a hand of gentleness and compassion, is so overcome with emotion, she begins to weep uncontrollably. The tears begin to flow down her face. Her tears are tears of joy. Her tears are tears of thankfulness. Her tears are tears of delight, relief. For here was a man who actually cared for her as a person, not as an object to be used. And she does something unthinkable to a Jewish woman. A Jewish woman would always keep their hair up and braided together. In the middle of this room, this Simon the Pharisee and all the other Pharisees around that table, tears flowing, she uses her tears to wash our Lord's feet. If that isn't extravagant, or maybe in what we would consider to be odd, she then undoes her hair and begins to clean his feet with her hair. This is extravagant. I say lavish, but maybe some of us would even say, this is ridiculous. She kisses, and then she breaks that alabaster flask, and she begins to anoint his feet with this scented oil. Friends, I don't feel like I can do actual emotional justice. Do you feel like I feel? That I am on holy ground when I read this text? Because here is a woman whose life has been forever changed and altered by the teaching of Jesus. And not just by the teaching of Jesus, but by Jesus silent bystanders. What we're intended to do is we are intended to marvel at the grace of God in this woman's life. Now at first when we're reading this, you may feel like this display of emotion and affection is excessive. If you find yourself, like I did this past week as I was studying this text, thinking like, that makes me uncomfortable, this is so excessive, then you and I may be more like Simon the Pharisee than we would like to admit. Let me keep reading here in verse 39. Now, when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, so he's thinking this, doesn't say this out loud, he says this in his head, right? This man were a prophet. He would have known who and what sort of woman this is who is touching him, for she is a sinner. Jesus answering, so now Jesus says it out loud. Jesus answering said to him, Simon, I have something to say to you. And he answered, say it, teacher. In his mind, Simon questions Jesus. What we're going to see next is this, is that friends, what do we tend to do? We tend to reserve mercy and grace for whom? We tend to reserve mercy and grace for for the self-righteous moralists. That is not whom Jesus extends mercy and grace to. Who does Jesus extend mercy and grace to? He extends mercy, grace, and forgiveness to the most extravagant of sinners in the city, this woman. So that's what I want you to see, number two, extravagant worship. And Jesus is going to pose a very simple story with a question. And Simon is going to get the question correct. He's going to answer it correctly. And why will Simon get the answer correct? Because religious legalists, moralists, always have the right answer. It's just that we tend not to live the right way. But we always have the right answer. The daily practice that we struggle with. Look at verse 41. He says, a certain money lender had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii. A denarii is a day's wage. So a year and a half or so. And the other 50 denarii. And when they could not pay, he canceled the debt of both. Now, Simon the Pharisee, which of them will love him more? Simon answered, the one, I suppose, for whom he canceled the larger debt. And he said to him, you have judged rightly. Now, here's what I want you to notice. I'm going to read verse 44, and I want you to look at the words very carefully. Then, here it is, turning toward the woman, he said to Simon. See what he's going to do? He's having this dialogue with Simon the Pharisee. And he gives this kind of this short, simple story about who has more joy, more forgiveness. And he turns toward the woman and he speaks to Simon the Pharisee behind him. And what does he say? Verse 44. Do you see this woman, Simon? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, right? That's basic, customary, obligatory hospitality. But she has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, Simon. But from the time I came in, she has not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not even anoint my head with incense oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. By turning from Simon and toward the woman, Jesus is visually, physically, demonstrably displaying to us this. Jesus is teaching us this, that who does he receive? Jesus receives sinners, not self-righteous moralists. He receives sinners. Why? Because extravagant sinners receiving extravagant forgiveness results in what? Lavish worship. So I've got no problem with you hearing how I sing. I got no problem with what you think about if I raise my hand in worship. Why? Because I know that Christ saved my soul. I want to say this. Your conscience may condemn you, friend. Your heart may criticize you. Your mind may disparage you of your past, but I want to say to you in the words of Christ that Jesus says, while staring into the woman's soul, her sins, which are many, are forgiven. There was a story. My parents became Christians before I was born, and so I was raised in a Christian home. I don't know if these stories are told at youth camps or youth conferences anymore, but I probably have heard this illustration on probably 4 to 6 times. And if you like to listen to podcast preachers or you dabble around on YouTube preachers, if you know the name Matt Chandler, Matt Chandler's a pastor at the Village Church up in Dallas, Texas, and I feel like he gives a much better illustration of what I'm about ready to share, but you may have heard a story, something like this. I remember as a teenager going to youth camps and youth conferences, and somewhere along the lines, they would always be talking about Christians and or Christian teenagers and sex. randomly, just depending on the size of the room, whether it was 50 kids or 200 kids or 1,000 kids, the preacher would begin his talk on Christian teenagers and sex. He would begin something like this. He would hold up a beautiful red rose. He would look at it and say, "Isn't this beautiful?" And he would smell it. He would say, "Oh, this smells so good." Then he would kind of talk about the beautiful, this beauty of this red rose. And he would come down somewhere and he would say, "Now I want you to take it." And so then Ben would take it and then he would pass it on. And it would go all the way throughout. And so the whole time, you know, the preacher is preaching on teenagers and Christian teenagers and sex, this rose being passed around. And of course, again, this is what I remember in my head. I'm sure this is not true of every Christian preacher that preached this way, but basically the end goal of, you know, the reason why you don't want to be involved in premarital sex is you don't want to have syphilis or gonorrhea, right? That was kind of it, right? And at the end of the sermon, right? At the end of the sermon, it would go something like this. He would kind of come to a crescendo, and the preacher would say, now where's the rose? And so some, you know, junior high boy in seventh grade would say, "Here it is." And he'd say, "Bring it down." And by the time the rose had been passed around, that group of 500 to 1,000 kids, or however many kids were there, at that event, of course, the petal is now falling off, and the stem is all broken. And he would hold that rose up, and he would say at the top of his lungs, "Who wants the rose? Who wants a rose like this?" I'm not sure, not every Christian preacher was this way, but what Luke 7 is teaching us is this, folks, is that Jesus is in the crowd and he's raising the hand when the preacher says, "Who wants the rose?" Jesus is saying, "I want the rose." Because the point of the Christian gospel is not full and final morality. The point of the Christian gospel is this, is that Jesus takes the sinner and he rescues them. And he doesn't just clean them up or moralize them in some way, but that Jesus takes and he cleanses and forgives of sin. So the point of the Christian gospel isn't perfect morality. The point of the Christian gospel is this, is that Jesus saves the sinner. See the difference? As I say all that, I bring all that, say, friends, I want Grace Life to be known as a place for extravagant sinners. Which means that as individual Christians, we must be a welcoming community for those where sin has ravaged. Why? Because I know in my heart of hearts that I am no different. Because the gospel of Jesus Christ teaches me this, that while my sins or your sins may not quote be as flagrant or as others, that my sin in my heart is just as wicked and deceptive and is despising God's. Are there Christian, are there individuals or groups of individuals that you avoid for fear somehow they will contaminate you? Or contaminate your family? What Jesus is teaching us here in Luke chapter 7 is that Jesus receives sinners. He has no problem engaging with the religious moralists, right? He went to the Pharisees' home to expose his religious hypocrisy. I want you to see how the individuals respond. Look at verse 46. Verse 46 says, "You do not anoint my head with oil, sorry, yeah, first verse, where you got another oil, but she has anointed my feet with oil. And therefore I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But he who is forgiven little loves much. And he said to her this, your sins are forgiven. Then they said to this, then those who were at the table with him began to say among themselves, who is this who even forgives sins? I'll tell you who he is, friend. Jesus is the gracious sin forgiver. He is the generous conscience cleanser. He is the merciful life restorer. He's the compassionate shame remover. And he is the benevolent soul rescuer. That's who my Jesus is. Now, one question that arises from the text is this. Were her sins forgiven because she did this? Like, if you'll do something extravagant too, then your sins will be forgiven. Is that how she got her sins forgiven? Well, no, the answer is found actually in verse 50, why her sins were forgiven. And Jesus said to the woman, what? Your faith, not the scented oil, not the breaking of the alabaster flask, but your faith has saved you. Go in peace. And the invitation to the Christian gospel is this, is to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm not just speaking that to people who have yet to express their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm speaking that to a room of people who have already done that. You need to continue to have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ to forgive you of your sins. Because you know what happens as a Christian? I mess up. What do? I punish myself, right? I don't know how you do it, but that's how I do it. I punish myself. How do I punish myself? Well, I stop reading the Bible for 2, 3, 4 days. Like, that's really good, right? That'll show Jesus that I'm really sorry for what I did. And that just starts a downward spiral, right? It just goes deeper and deeper and deeper. No. How are we saved on a continual basis? Yes, we're saved once and for all. But the point is that our faith is in the finished work of Christ. Not in what we can do. In fact, I would put it this way. Let me say this emphatically. It's not the amount. It's not the size of your faith. It is what? It is the object of your faith. Whether you got little, itty, bitty faith, or you got lots of faith, the point is not the amount. The point is always, where is your faith? The object in Christ. So we have this lavish worship, extravagant of forgiveness. And finally, I want you to see what I'm calling gospel team. In chapter 8, the rabbis refused to teach women. And Jesus taught them freely. He didn't just teach them freely. He didn't just stop there. He actually admitted them into fellowship and accepted their service. And three are named here. You see them in Luke chapter 8, verse 1. Soon afterward, Jesus went on through cities and villages, proclaiming and bringing the good news of the kingdom of God. And the 12 were with him. And also some women who had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities. Mary, called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had gone. Joanna, the wife of Chuza, Herod's household manager. And Susanna. Then it says this, and many others who provided for them out of their means. Is that a little bit shocking to you? We think of Jesus and the 12 disciples, but at least in this case, there were a group of women who traveled with and ministered with Jesus. These women are not just patrons, kind of giving out of their wealth. They actually traveled and ministered alongside our Lord. I think this is important for us, right? As a Christian church. In the Christian church, there are two offices, that of elder or pastor. We use them interchangeably. The Bible uses them interchangeably. Two offices, there's many different roles and responsibilities and various ways to serve, but there's two offices within the church. There's the office of pastor and elder in 1 Timothy 3, Titus chapter 1. And that office, according to 1 Timothy 3 and Titus 1, is reserved for men who are qualified to fill those roles. But the other office, the office of deacon, is not just for men, but it's also for women. The Bible actually allows but encourages female deacons. We can see this in 1 Timothy 3. So on a side note, I would love to see our church grow in the number of female deacons that we have serving for the unity of the body of Christ. Grace Life, I want to speak to you as your pastor just for a moment. We do not desire to be traditional for traditional sake. What do we desire to be around? We desire to reflect a church that is governed and directed by God. We desire for women to serve in Christian service as the Bible teaches. For instance, in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul gives advice, gives teaching to the Corinthian church. He says that when women pray and prophesy within the church, well, what does that mean? Well, when we have Trish read scripture for us this morning. This is one of the reasons why we have ladies reading scripture in our worship service. When women are leading us in worship, they are prophesying, they are telling truth, they are speaking out truth, they are singing truth. It's not often that women pray publicly in our worship service, but according to 1 Corinthians 11, it could be the normal thing. It should be the normal. You see, for Jesus' day, Jesus' ministry was radical. What if this Christian church was equally radical? And here's what I mean. Let me take this story now, this woman, and this opening three verses and bring them together. Here's what I mean by radical. People often consider the church to be for good people, the moralists. What if Grace Life became known as a place where skeptics were not just welcomed, but brought into an inner circle of relationship? What if those who have experimented with every fruit of the sexual revolution and found it to be unsatisfying would call Grace Life home, and they would find it to be a space to ask difficult questions in our culture about sexuality, but they would find equally difficult answers that accurately reflect the scriptures in a spirit of love. See, one reason why a Christian church must hold true to historic Christian teachings on marriage and sexuality is for this reason. Women individuals have experimented with every possible fruit of the sexual revolution, that there must be a place where they can come and find rest and peace. What if immigrants who practice other religions found the Christians of Grace Life to be the kindness of people in their schools, in their apartments, and in their neighborhoods? You see how this could reflect Luke chapter 7? Christian, what if, when your conscience accuses you, and you doubt your standing before Christ, would this be radical for you? It is radical for me because I teach this to myself weekly. That when my conscience accuses and I doubt my standing before Jesus, that you too, and that we would remind ourselves of the life-changing, soul-freeing, sin-cleansing gospel of Jesus Christ. That would be radical, even for Christian churches. I'm going to close with this. this illustration introduce you to a lady. You ever see her books? Pick them up and read them. Her name is Rosaria Butterfield. Rosaria served in the English department at Syracuse University. From 1992 to 2002. Her academic interest while she was teaching there at Syracuse University was focused on feminist theory, queer theory, and 19th century British lit. She was a self-espoused lesbian with a partner. The year was 1996 or 97. She wrote an op-ed piece in the local newspaper there in Syracuse University. It's basically along this line, why are Christians so hateful to the LGBTQ community? In response, godly Christian pastor, Presbyterian pastor there, and his wife reached out to Rosaria. For the next 2 to 3 years, they invited her over to their home with her partner. The next 2 to 3 years, every week. Over time, it just ended up being Rosaria, but I don't think they invited her to church, from what I understand, for at least two years or so. Just getting to know another, and she was able to ask question after question after question after question to this Christian pastor and his wife. That meal that initially started began as a 2 to 3 year friendship. And over time, this professor became fast friends with this dear pastor and his wife. It was 1999, if I recall correctly. Two momentous occasions happened in Rosaria's life. One, she obtained tenure there at Syracuse University. The second thing that happened was this: she became a follower of Jesus. You can read her biography in her first book titled "The Secret Thoughts of an Unlikely Convert." Do your soul good. Somewhere after that, eventually she and partner separated. God has used her in tremendous, tremendous ways in the Christian church and in our culture at large, arguing for a biblical understanding of sexuality, for a biblical understanding of the gospel, how the gospel changes lives. Friends, I say this to you, and you would even, if you're here this morning and you're like, man, Joel, I identify as gay or lesbian, or maybe you would even say you struggle or you wrestle with same-sex attraction. It's not, I don't say any of those words to beat you up, but actually to provide a place where difficult questions can be received with difficult answers, that the gospel of Jesus Christ can answer those questions. A grace life that from my right all the way over to my left, as we go out into our community, that we would be known how Jesus was. Jesus did not push off, quote, the worst. He actually embraced this. Through his teachings, men and women like these individuals here came to faith. Say to us, Grace Life, if we see ourselves as any better, then we do not understand the Christian gospel. The Christian gospel teaches us this. In my heart of hearts, I'm as bad and as wicked as anyone and the person next to me. Only through Jesus and the good news that he can save the rest of us. This is what Jesus has come to do. This is what he's come to save you from as well. We need to.